Do you know, Claire? It was a clear day 60 years ago with the wind in the right direction. I'm pretty sure I'd be staring right into the eyeballs of the Germans.
Oh, that is the British pop star.
60 years ago, the White Cliffs of Dover were quite literally the front line. If we were to defeat the Germans, then we'd have to fight our way to Berlin, all the way from the beaches of northern France. That fight started on the 6th of June, 1944, D-Day.
We want to celebrate the day the war turned in our favour, which is why we've come to a collection of old tanks in Kent in search of a D-Day warrior to bring back to life. Our target, the M10 tank destroyer.
Is that one ours, Claire?
No, this is an American thing called a Chaffee.
Never heard of it. Well, it's got to be one of these, Claire, is that it?
No, that's a Russian T-34.
I knew that.
Well, that's looking more promising.
Well, what do you reckon, Claire? Is this our baby?
Well, it could be.
What do you mean, it could be?
Well, give me a chance to have a look inside.
Flaming tank spotter.
Well, it's a bit of a hybrid.
Just like D-Day itself, the M10 Achilles tank destroyer was a joint British-American venture. Something of a Tankenstein monster, in fact.
The main part of it is an American thing called an M10, and we've got a plaque here that says so. But the British got hold of it and put a massive 17-pounder gun on it and called it an Achilles. And judging by the size of this, that's what we have here.
Although it looks just like a tank, the M10 is in fact a self-propelled gun. Like a tank, but with lighter armour.
That's what you call a tow.
If we are going to restore this monster, we've got to drag it out of the scrapyard first. And don't worry, we do have the owner's permission. Rex Cadman is the custodian of these relics of combat. And he's agreed that we can try fixing up his old Achilles, so long as we can get it as close to D-Day spec as possible.
And what's so special about this particular one?
Well, it's the M10 Achilles. It's got the 17-pounder gun, which was the biggest gun we produced towards the latter part of the Second World War. And it's the same as the German Firefly, and these were ideal for knocking out the Tiger tanks.
The German Tigers?
Yeah.
And so a very important part of our efforts in the Second World War.
Absolutely, yeah. Without these, the Second World War might have had a different result.
60 years ago, our M10 was a key weapon in securing the Allied bridgehead in northern France. And I'm keen that we find somewhere that looks as much like Normandy as possible for her to strut her stuff once she's finished.
Rex, this is a big job, isn't it?
It is. Yeah, there's a few months' work here.
Claire, get cracking.
Luckily, I'm not going to be doing it all myself. Not only have we commandeered Rex's M10, but we've managed to pull in the best tank restorers in the country, Steve Cobb and his assistant Bill. Steve's a true tank expert. He's restored dozens of Rex's rusting relics, including another veteran of the landings, this beach recovery vehicle. It was designed to work in up to 9 feet of water to keep the way clear for monster machines like our M10 to storm up the beach. So it's fitting that it's now pulling our rusting relic into the workshop, setting it on the first stage of the road to recovery.
Oi, Professor! You're gonna need this!
Thank you.
Armed with the ID plate and the serial number of our M10, I'm off to do the hard work, dusting down some documents at the archive to hopefully find out the history of our Achilles and maybe even somebody who stormed the beaches in one.
Call that hard work! While Suggs is lifting the lid on the M10's past, Steve and I are going to try to bring history back to life. Just like a World War II maintenance crew out in the field, we'll be working in the cold and the mud, pulling apart 30 tons of Second World War steel, finding replacement parts for a 60-year-old gun, and restoring an engine that's become home to a family of mice. And only then will we start putting it all back together again.
This week's Salvage Squad Restoration is a Second World War M10 Achilles tank destroyer, a key anti-tank weapon that fought from the beaches of Normandy all the way to Berlin. As usual, I'll be doing all the heavy brain work while Claire gets on with the tarting.
First task in restoration, take the whole thing apart, By the end of today, we're hoping to get 2 1.5-ton engines out the back and this brute of a turret on the floor.
For all that it's huge, it's pretty simple. The hull and running gear is nicked off a Sherman tank. On top, there's an open-top turret large enough to house the 17-pounder gun. 17 pounds, because that was the weight of the huge shells it fires. The power? That comes from 2 Chrysler diesels at the back, driving a gearbox at the front. But before we can get to the innards of the Achilles, we've got to prise its 4-ton turret off. And for that, we've had to hire in a massive 25-ton crane and a lot of extra labour. Back in the war, lads like Steve would have been expected to do this kind of work in the field, and they wouldn't have had such a fancy crane either.
Hey, he's happy!
Getting the turret off went really smoothly. Simply a matter of applying 4 tons of anti-gravity to it. That's because there was nothing holding it on.
Well, the lift went really well, much better than we actually expected, but we realised it's because we're missing the sort of rotating ring. It's a big gearing system that sits here and moves the gun round. And if we can't find one of those, it's a big problem because we're not going to be able to move a gun.
The missing ring is in fact the huge bearing between the hull and the turret. Not only does it keep the turret on, but it allows the crew to traverse the gun onto its target. So it's kind of essential, and getting a new one might cause us some problems.
Up a touch. Up a bit.
Suggs can deal with a ring, as that will involve a few phone calls and perhaps a library or two. Meanwhile, we've got to get the power pack to come out, and that means removing the radiators and exhausts first. And they're being a lot more stubborn than the turret was.
See, won't we?
Can't side over either, can we?
You will.
Are you going to pick that up?
No.
Come down gently. Whoa.
It's just going to go flat. Oh.
Well, the radiators put up a struggle, but they surrendered in the end. Now for the exhaust mufflers. But they're stuck fast too.
This casting's been stuck on a pipe for quite some time, and so taking it apart, it really doesn't want to go. Put a bit of heat on it, and now with a gentle application of the hammer, hopefully it should all come apart. There you go. One more bit apart. We need these, don't we?
Yeah, we do, definitely.
With the radiators and the exhaust mufflers out, we can now turn our attention to her massive 2-stroke diesel engines, each weighing over a ton.
It's taken 3 hours to get this far, and I've got the dirty hands and scraped knuckles to prove it. But we think we've found every last nut and bolt that's holding that engine in the tank.
Bingo! The engines are out. Mind you, they're not looking too hot.
Well, it's the end of a long day, but we've got the engine out and the turret off. But to be honest, that's just brought home the scale of the whole task in hand.
The engines are not looking good, and the tracks will need an overhaul. That's just the obvious stuff. The biggest problem is going to be finding the missing ring to bolt the turret back onto.
With Claire getting worried about a bit of work, I was about to engage with the archives once more.
This is Woolwich, home of the Royal Artillery Museum. And if anyone can tell us a bit about the history of our Achilles, it's this lot. For behind these walls is a huge archive of material detailing the machines and people that fought for the artillery regiment.
The British bit of the M10 is its gun, a 17-pound brute which was originally designed as a normal field gun. It performed so well in North Africa that the boffins back home came up with the idea of popping it into the shiny new M10s that had arrived from America. The result was a tank destroyer capable of wiping out even the mighty Tiger tank, according to museum curator Paul Evans.
The Tiger tank was the tank of the war. All sides thought it was the best tank. It had the best gun, had the best range. It was a ferocious tank to go up against. No one liked going up against it. It could beat you. Everybody knew it could beat the Sherman tank.
But so we were desperately looking for something that could stop it in its tracks?
Absolutely. So we came up with the 17-pounder. 17-pounder can destroy a Tiger tank. In the meantime, we've got lend-lease with the Americans, and the Americans are lending lots of their stuff, and they've lent the M10 to us. The M10 is a tank destroyer. It's a 3-inch gun, but it's an American gun, so obviously American gun, American ammunition. We've got the 17-pounder that we know works. So we do no more than take their gun off, put our gun on. And that's your Achilles.
We brought the American tanks here and we just fitted our own guns to it.
We did, but it's not a tank. It's an American term is a tank destroyer. We call them anti-tank guns. It looks like a tank, and I know it looks like a tank. It's not as thickly armored as a tank. It'll go faster, and that's what we wanted. We wanted mobility.
Well, Paul, I wonder if you're going to help. I've got a plate here from our M10 with a serial number on it. Do you think there's any chance we'd actually be able to find out anything about our individual Achilles?
Not after this amount of time, no. But what we can do is provide you with a lot of information about the regiments and units that used the Achilles.
Great. Okay. Can we have a look at those?
Yes.
The nameplates and serial numbers soon get forgotten when the hostilities are over. But one thing that's never thrown away is the memories of the men who served. And with any luck, I'll be able to track down an M10 vet through the regimental diaries.
Back at the restoration, and work has started on the turret, but we've discovered some inconsistencies that Steve's not happy with. The turret is made up of three parts: the housing, the gun, and the mantlet, which is the protective screen for the gunner. The problem is, the mantlet on our M10 isn't from the Second World War.
Now, we're not happy with the mantlet on the front section of the gun here. And Steve, why do you want to go to the bother of changing it?
Well, there's nothing particularly wrong with the turret, but unfortunately, during its life, after the use by the British and the Americans, various armies adapted this to do other things. They've unfortunately welded up the telescope hole and adapted the mantlet to fit a machine gun.
Right, so you want to take it back to the original?
Yeah, it has to go back to original. But
and all these holes that they've cut are all in the wrong places for us?
Yes, however, out there somewhere we do have a spare gun and a mantlet, which is correct, so we will change them over.
We're really lucky, aren't we? How many other people have got access to spare parts of a 17-pounder?
Luckily not many, except us.
It's unfair to call Rex's yard a scrapyard. It's not. It's a massive collection of military kit awaiting restoration. Unfortunately, it's not exactly well catalogued. So I hope Steve can remember where our mantlet is. But before we can start searching, we need to split the old gun apart using a special technique devised by Steve himself. A Titanic tank tug of war.
This isn't model engineering, this is pretty heavy stuff. And we're going to pull this apart using the counterweight of that tank there, 70 tons. That should do it.
In the green corner, a brute of a Conqueror main battle tank. And in the blue corner, Steve is sporting this fetching Abbott self-propelled gun. Seconds out, round one.
Go on then, take it away.
Amazingly, to keep the law happy, all you need to own a monster gun like this is an ordinary shotgun license.
You're never going to believe this, but you can still fire this gun. No one spiked it. All I need to do is find a shell for it and then pack it full of dynamite.
As Steve takes our demantleted gun to the workshops, I'm at the Artillery Museum about to get my hands on the crown jewels. The official war diaries of the men who fought their way ashore on D-Day.
Okay, right, anti-tank regiments. Now we have to make a choice of regiment. This will hold all the information you need. 86 anti-tank, they had a good campaign in Normandy. 68 again.
Excellent.
Good ones. And I'll carry 93 for you.
Brilliant. Every commander had to keep a record of his regiment's activities, a ship's log, if you will, of the route and tasks carried out by the crews. And these are the diaries of the battery commanders from a regiment that were armed with M10 Achilles and arrived in France shortly after D-Day. Have a listen to some of this. As proof that the Achilles M10 was starting to have some effect, there's one here from a Major V.A. Arnold, which says, K Troop destroyed 2 Tiger tanks and 1 Mark IV and a reconnaissance vehicle. Their casualties were 1 sergeant and 2 gunners, killed with 4 gunners wounded and 1 M10 burnt out. But L Troop destroyed 3 Tiger tanks and 1 Fokker Wolf plane, casualties nil. It's quite extraordinary reading these. I didn't imagine this was how a campaign of this sort was recorded. And there's absolutely no emotion or sentimentality in any of these reports. It's very black and white. Vehicles destroyed and people killed, and that's it. But there's a very interesting one here, actually, from September 1944, which says, battery remains concentrated in South Iran all day. While on a recce up towards Iran, the Major R.C. Nightingale was killed when enemy anti-tank fire hit the vehicle in which he was travelling. But a Captain A. Booth assumed control of this battery. And that's very interesting, because Paul here has already told me that there's a Major Booth that's still alive, who is a commander of a battery of Achilles M10s. And I think it would be great if we could get in touch with him and find out what life was really like in and around those vehicles during the war.
Meanwhile, me and Steve have taken a break from scouring Rex's yard for the replacement mantlet.
If you're going to restore stuff like this, you've got to be an optimist, haven't you?
Yes. I mean, if you gave up every time something went wrong, none of this would ever get done. And this field would still be full. But you plough on. You find a way around it.
And do you find that satisfying?
You do when you accomplish and it's done. When it rolls out of the workshop and it goes off to its owner and they're happy with it, job done. And it's nice to find old people that used to drive them. And as long as they're happy, then you're happy. Mm-hmm. What you don't want is someone who's drove them in the war come along and think, oh, you didn't do a very good job of that.
Well, that's why we're trying our best on this one, to get the right parts and do a proper job.
Because people do exist that still drove these.
All right, let's go and find this mantle.
Yep, let's.
What colour is it?
It's yellow, a sort of very musty yellow.
I don't believe you. I reckon it's rust-coloured, just like everything else around.
Mind you, we did put it somewhere, so chances are it's one with the weeds now. There it is.
In the undergrowth.
Yeah,
I suspected.
Where I thought it would be.
Is it all there?
Yep, that's what we need. And as you can see, that's the hole they filled in.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no hole there, which is ideal for what we need.
Excellent.
So I'll get the forklift and I'll get it out for you.
Brilliant. Thank you. There you go. You can do that tug of war thing again.
So that's one spare part crossed off the list. But sadly, Rex's yard can't supply the huge ring that will eventually attach the turret to the hull. Amazingly, Rex's yard is not unique. The country's littered with rusting armies.
How you doing? All right. I wonder if you can help me. I'm on a rather desperate search for an M10 turret ring.
You'll be lucky. We haven't got one here. It's very rare.
I know that.
And if your local tank dealer can't supply, then head down to your local newsagents and reach up to the top shelf.
This is quite incredible. You can literally buy yourself a tank. That'd sort out the parking problems, wouldn't it, my darling?
But even though the mags are full of dealers, finding the right ring for our M10 is proving difficult.
No, not a wedding ring. Ha 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 ha. No, a tank ring. You do models. Oh, right, no. I was saying, sorry, you just specialise in Tudor armoury. Sorry to bother you, thank you very much. Well, maybe I could come and have a look, yeah. Okay, that's great, thanks very much. Don't sell it to anyone else, will you?
Blimey, this looks like where the Third Reich parked up in 1945. My magazine search has led me to Carl Brown's military muscle stash. Hopefully they've got some British parts here too.
Hello.
Carl.
Hey, nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. Yeah, let's go this way.
Wow, Carl, you got some stuff here, eh?
Oh, yeah, excellent. It's really good stuff, yeah.
What is this?
This is one of our Russian tanks, a T-72, state-of-the-art thing. We use it on films, and this is one that was used in the Bond film, Die Another Day.
Fantastic. Looks a bit mean, yes.
Oh, yeah, definitely. The mean of the Russian tank world.
And what's this young man here all about?
This is one of our... This is our Tiger tank replica, built on a Russian tank chassis.
Yes. The arch-enemy of our Achilles M10.
Indeed. That's exactly what it was up against in Normandy.
And a nice bit of airtexing here, which is lovely.
Yeah, this is meant to replicate the Zimmerit anti-magnetic mine paste. The idea was to stop the British and the Americans sticking magnetic mines onto them.
Brave chaps, weren't they? Well, he's coming towards you. You're going to stick a mine on the bonnet.
Definitely brave.
But I wonder if you could help me. I'm after a ring, I'm led to believe.
Turret ring for your M10?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I reckon I've got just the kiddie for you, so follow me.
Fantastic.
Whilst I've been up north, the grubby ones have been making a hell of a mess. They've got the shot blaster out, and 60 years of history are coming off in the form of muck and grease, and enough red oxides going back on to keep the M10 rust-free for a century.
Look, Bruce, we've got visitors. Hello.
Hello, Claire.
You bought me a present?
I've got you the ring.
Aren't I a lucky girl?
It doesn't mean we're engaged. But yep.
What a lucky girl.
And this is Carl.
Hi, Carl.
Hi, nice to meet you.
What have we got here? A brand new ring?
A reconditioned, genuine World War II ring, ready
Fantastic.
To fit.
Fantastic.
All we've got to do now is lift it on. Thank heavens for cranes.
I'm going to step through here and go into another time-space continuum.
Oh, don't do that.
Hey, I'm on salvage squad. How did I end up here?
Not by getting your hands dirty, at least until now.
The tank has changed so much, it's unbelievable.
I should hope so. It was a rusting hulk last time I saw it.
Well, it's covered in sand, but it's looking good.
Hey, yeah. Well, looking good.
It's had a coat of red oxide to keep the rust off.
Excellent.
But it's just so big, it takes ages. Doesn't it, Steve?
It does. It's about 5 days in all, in total, blasting so far.
Yeah?
And priming.
So is this ring going to fit in here?
We're pretty certain it's going to fit in the inside of the hull. The hull should line up. It's the inner ring we're worried about, the one that takes a turret. And that's mainly because it's a reconditioned ring which isn't as old as a tank.
So it's a later post.
It's a much later one. And the different countries that had these hulls, they put crane jibs on, counterweight, all sorts of things. And there's a few telltale signs on the inner ring at the moment that, to me, suggest it won't.
Did you get to keep the receipt?
Do you know the palaver I went through to get that thing? I'm not taking it back. We've got to make it fit.
Oh, dear. I hope I haven't been taken for a ride. The boy definitely said it was genuine World War II. But then what would I know? The only way to find out is to lift it up and put it on, taking extreme care not to take out the workshop door.
Just about going to make it.
You have to be careful not to punch a hole in the ceiling.
Claire, it's upside down.
Shh. Watch it.
About 6 inches to the right. Well, that's my right, that way.
Now, those bits of wood are clever. I'd have just dropped it down, then wondered why I couldn't get the chains off.
So now we need the largest toothpick we can find, or as it's known in the trade, a crowbar. Ugh, got the trusty crowbar.
Oh, only a little one, mine.
Is it overlapping a bit at your end?
Yeah, it's like it needs to go.
Yeah, right. I'll lift up a little bit, jimmy over to Suggs.
So we get rid of that block.
Well, what do we reckon? Gonna fit?
Dunno, we're reserving judgment on that.
Or is it gonna drop straight through?
That's two.
Here we go. Whoa!
Bingo.
Look, Nearly got the bolt holes lined up as well.
Excellent.
Oh, they're just slightly off.
Lovely.
Thank you very much, Claire.
Okay. You have your uses.
And of course, it should move, should it not?
It should.
That's the idea.
Yep.
Hey, so the turret sits on top of that?
Yeah, the turret sits on top, and it's interesting because it's ball bearings inside a rail with grease actually allows it to rotate. And this is different from most tanks in the fact that the 17-pounder gun, when it was fitted, upset the whole balance of the turret, mm-hmm. being much heavier. So they actually adapted an armoured car steering wheel through a separate manual gearbox to drive it.
So is it hand-operated?
Yes, no power at all.
No! Yeah. That's your job.
Must have been a bit desperate, eh, if the enemy were coming towards you from behind, eh?
Quick, quick, quick.
Well, anyway, well done, everyone. I'm afraid my work here today is done.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Good. See you later.
See you later.
Bye-bye.
I don't know what they'd do without me, I really don't. But we're a long way from finishing this old baby. There's two sod-off motors not working, and a couple of tracks not tracking. Not to mention a gun in two pieces. It's 60 years since the Allies stormed the Normandy beaches and began the campaign which would eventually lead to victory in the Second World War. And this week's challenge is to restore a 30-ton D-Day veteran, an M10 Achilles. Even after my valiant efforts finding the ring, at this point in the restoration, the whole thing looks a bit like a large skip. So, I've decided to abandon the workshop to meet up with another D-Day veteran. A man by the name of Major Albert Booth. The very same Major A. Booth I read about in the Woolwich archives. 60 years ago, his regiment landed in Normandy and were immediately given a welcome to remember by the Germans.
We lost 6 out of 12 tanks of our armoured vehicles the first time we went into action, which was, I can remember putting my head down that night and trying to get a couple of hours sleep and thinking, my God, if this is war, I can't see myself living very long. But however, I survived.
But his battery soon found their feet, and it wasn't long before they were celebrating their first Tiger kill.
But you did definitely take out a Tiger tank as well.
Rather interesting. The gun layer, with one shot, he hit the Tiger tank, it right in the middle, an absolute perfect shot, and he waved his hat in the air, and that was that.
And just to prove it, Major Booth still has a picture of the battery's first Tiger kill. Ample evidence that once in the 17-pounder's sights, even the mighty Tiger didn't have a chance.
The M10 Achilles was based on the American Sherman tank. And it's its American two-stroke diesel engines that are giving us trouble. One is a runner, but the other refuses to start. So, in his pursuit of power pack perfection, Steve has decided on a complete overhaul.
Steve, I don't know where to start on this engine. It's looking a complete mess to me.
This one's fine.
Is this a runner?
This is a runner. This one's pretty good.
What about the other engine?
The other engine, the governor's not working properly at all.
So you can't run it at a constant speed?
No, it'll rev up, it revs down, it dies. It's just not keeping itself at any regular interval.
Right, can we fix that?
Yes, okay. That can be fixed.
Next one?
Is when you rev it up, the exhaust was coming out of the water pipes, which is a...
You don't have to be an expert to know it's a bad
that's
thing.
That's not good.
So the...
And it's oil literally coming out of the exhaust pipe, just throwing oil out.
All right, so that's a number of things you flagged up there. What's the bottom line? Is it fixable? Can it run?
It's fixable. It might run.
The main problem with our knackered engine is that it's leaking like a sieve. Oil is ending up where only water or exhaust should be. So it looked like we were in need of a new head gasket. But when we pulled it all apart, things were much worse.
This little scratch here on the surface is actually a huge crack through the cylinder head. So unfortunately, this big lump is just scrap, and we're going to have to find another one.
Next on our engine's list of ailments was the supercharger. Its job is to pump air into the cylinders to help burn more diesel and give a bigger bang.
When the supercharger acts as a pump, it pulls air from outside and forces it into the engine. We're talking quite high pressures here, so if there are any gaps or leaks, it will find it. And it did. On our supercharger, it found four faulty seals, which meant that it was actually sucking oil from the engine into the supercharger. As a result, we've had to send for a special order of new seals from America, and it's taken its time.
With Claire struggling with our metal veteran's engine, I was having better luck in my search for veterans of the flesh and blood variety.
Meeting Major Boud was interesting, but he landed in Normandy 2 weeks after D-Day. What I need is to find somebody who was there during the first wave.
Luckily, my search at the Royal Artillery Museum threw up another name, Ron Taylor. So I'm off to meet him now.
With the new seals for the supercharger winging their way across the Atlantic, the whole workshop is on painting duty. The outside of the hull was painted the predictable olive drab. But inside the hull, it was so dingy they painted everything white to maximise the light. Out in the yard, even the tracks are getting the once over.
With the artists worrying about which colour to paint, I was back in black and white land. Ron Taylor was a radio operator in an M10 bound for the Normandy beaches. But amazingly, he had little knowledge of his destination until the last minute.
We went to Tilbury Dock and embarked on a Liberty ship on the Sunday evening of the 4th. And then we set sail overnight and sailed out into the Channel. But where we went to then, I just don't know. And we'd no knowledge of where we were going. And until the invasion was announced on the ship's radio on the Tuesday morning, we'd no knowledge of what was happening. And then, of course, we knew the same as the general public.
Ron's M10 stormed up the beach on D-Day plus one and was immediately put into action, moving on with the advancing troops, providing cover and knocking out strong points.
We didn't drive into action like as a tank might be. It's an attacking weapon. We were a defensive weapon, so we more or less followed up the attacking troops and to serve as backup should they be forced to retire through counterattacks.
For all that it looks like a tank, the M10 is basically a well-armed field gun on tracks, designed mainly to ambush advancing enemy armour.
It was a different thing in operation because the tank had got a turret that was mechanically activated, whereas with ours you had to wind it round with a wheel. It wasn't the sort of thing that you could flash around and shoot indiscriminately. It took you quite a time to get it lined up to fire. We were always taught to aim for the turret ring, or if possible from the rear, the tracks and the bogus to immobilise it that way. And where the turret joins the tank, that obviously is his weak point, to try and aim for that. But if the thing was coming head on, then you hadn't much chance.
Back at the workshops, Steve and Bill are working late into the night to refit the M10's tracks. The hundreds of individual links that make up the tracks are the most vulnerable part of any tank, and crews regularly had to refit them in the field.
Right, so we're not missing links then?
No, we're not. This is exactly what came off, so should, in theory, go straight back on again. You scrap to go round the cleat, join us, because we won't go round the wheel.
Rejoining the tracks is a matter of pulling them together with a chain ratchet before hammering in the joiner.
These joiners are late period war, mm-hmm. because the early wartime ones are a lot thinner and had a tendency of cracking, especially in the Ardennes where these were. Obviously the winter and the freezing cold, they were cracking, so they made these ones which are later, a lot fatter,
yeah.
to take the strain and the
beefed it up.
Cold.
So, sort of when you're in a sort of an action situation, if you lose these clamps...
You lose the clamps, you lose your track.
You lose your
and
track.
If your track goes off the front and you lose both, you've got no way of stopping. So unless those wheels dig themselves in the ground, you will just roll and keep going. So losing it on the road is not a good idea.
No.
Don't think the insurance would pay out on that one.
So instead of carrying spare tyres, do you carry spare track sections?
Yeah, you can carry... These
tracks.
Usually have about eight or so track blocks on the front. This carries cleats down the side, but there's lots of photos from the war where they've got whole sections of track laid all over them, mainly extra armour.
In all, around 400 Achilles poured onto the Normandy coast on D-Day. It was the perfect place for an invasion. Relatively remote, with easy access for the ships coming in, and flat countryside inland. Not unlike Muckleborough in Norfolk, where I've come to meet with Neil Story.
So Neil, why do you think this is a good place for us to test our Achilles?
This is the ideal place. You've got all the terrains you need. You've got grass surfaces, you've got mud, you've got shale, you've got grit, and you've got water. It's all here.
Everything a tank can expect to meet in a battlefield.
Absolutely right. There's no mountains here, but you don't get many tanks up mountains.
In fact, Muckleborough is so like Normandy that some say Hitler would have used it for his own version of D-Day, had it ever happened.
There's an old couplet. It goes something like, he who old England would hope to win must at Weybourne Hope begin. That out there, that's Weybourne Hope. That's a natural harbour. There've been invaders and attackers from the Romans to Kaiser Bill to Hitler. They've all had that as a target. Because on there, you can get invasion barges right up close. This could have been Hitler's D-Day. And you can just sweep straight in. If Hitler had got a toehold here, well, because that is so easy and so accessible, just roll the vehicles up, you'd have been in real trouble here.
You and I will be speaking German today now.
I hope not.
The idea is that we'll bring our M10 up here to test her out in terrain similar to the flatlands of Normandy she rolled across 60 years ago. But how do we know she was actually there? I'd taken the maker's plate to the Royal Artillery Museum, but without much luck.
Do you think there's any chance we'd actually be able to find out anything about our individual Achilles?
Not after this amount of time, no.
But there is a clue on the tank itself.
These welds on the back panel all match this drawing here, which is provided for the crews to actually configure these vehicles for deep wading.
Right, so that's a big snorkel in effect coming
out. Yeah, basically, this back one is for the exhaust of both the engine and the radiators, and the one in front of it is for the intake for the engine.
Right, so it stops all the water rushing into the engine.
Just stops everything getting in there.
Right, now if we're going to put this back as near as we can to Second World War Normandy landing specification, we're going to have to get these made, aren't we?
We are.
Because we're not going to buy them off the shelf.
No, this is going to be one of the only ones with wading gear. We know there's one Stuart, which is a slightly smaller tank with it, but as of that, we've not seen any other wading gear on anything because it's not meant to stay on.
What? Oh, right, why not?
It's, as soon as it got off the boat, it was to come off.
Immediately?
Immediately.
How do they do that?
Usually they swung the turret around and the gun would take them off, mainly because you didn't want to stick outside when the snipers are out.
The ducks were only designed to get the tank up the beach. If they'd stayed on it any longer, they'd have caused the engines to overheat. But where'd you go to get spare parts for a Second World War tank? Same place as the army goes for their tank bits. Abro, near Telford.
Right, is it fair to say you've been volunteered for this job?
Pushed into it, Mike.
Press gang.
Yeah.
Well, this is all the information I've got. Got all these fantastic pretty pictures of our Second World War tank destroyer, but I don't actually have a measured drawing, so we're going to have to make it to fit.
These boys are second year apprentices at Abro, but if it was 1944, they'd have been getting ready for Normandy, and it would have been girls like me making the ducts. In fact, British industry went into overdrive making wading gear, with companies like MG turning out 3,000 units in just a few weeks. With the Abro boys sparking away on the ducts, I headed back down to Kent. It's been 2 months since we started the M10, and now most of the work has been done. The tracks are on, and the engines are back in, so we can turn our attention to the turret.
Right, the mission for today is to put the correct mantlets on the gun, and the whole lot in the turret. To achieve this mission, we need a forklift truck, a Conqueror main battle tank, and some troops. First bit, the troops are moving in with the forklift truck. Stay Phase one accomplished. There's always one last job. I know it doesn't look gentle, but Steve's at one with his forklift. She's all greased up, she's got one bolt in there, and she's over to the turret. Just again.
Finally, our gun is assembled.
That worked out all right, didn't it?
All we have to do now is to drag out the hull, and we can put the whole lot back together again.
Well, our M10 is back out in the sunshine only 2 months after it first went into the workshop. Steve has really been putting in the hours on this project, and full credit to him, it's looking amazing. Now, the only thing left to do is to pick up the turret and the gun and put it on the tank. And when we fire this thing up, we will have the only working M10 Achilles tank in the entire world.
After all this brutish bashing, there's just one thing we've got to do before we can head up to Norfolk. Lift 4 tons of turret, 12 feet in the air, and drop it neatly back on the hull.
I know I said all we've got to do is put the turret on top of the tank, but what I didn't mention is we don't actually know whether this thing will fit the ring, and Steve's not optimistic.
So, after all this work, we are just inches from success or failure.
A wee bit more.
Either we'll have the only working M10 Achilles in the world, or we'll have a restored hull and a restored turret that won't fit together.
Two together, there.
And it will all be my fault. 2 months ago, this M10 was lying rusting away in a Kentish field. Now, after a Herculean effort by Steve Cobb and a lot of cranes, we're inches away from success or failure.
Pull it round, see if it'll pull round a bit, yeah.
Even at this late stage, we're not 100% sure if the bolt holes are going to line up.
Steve, those two ones that are close together?
Yeah, those two close together go there. And you've got another two close together there.
Right.
It's a rough guess. We think it's about, because these two holes, we can only use one of them.
Yeah.
So I think it's this one's there, I think.
With 6 tons swaying around at the end of a long crane, this thing was never going to be an easy job, but the wind's really, really picked up as well, and that's making our life incredibly difficult.
Ooh. All right, hold it there.
Despite our worries, it seems that Suggs bought the right ring after all. And our turret nestles down perfectly. In 42 bolts time, we'll have restored the last of the M10 Achilles, the tank destroyers that could take on a Tiger and win.
Three days later, on what could have been the location for Hitler's version of D-Day, and our M10 is reunited with Ron Taylor, a veteran who rode one through Normandy 60 years ago. Immediately, the memories of those days come flooding back.
Gosh, this does look immaculate inside, doesn't it? Because we used to have the racks at the back with the ammunition in there.
What was it like when the gun fires?
Well, extremely noisy, and the dust shot out from under the floor, the smell of cordite, and...
Does the tank shake itself?
Oh, yes, absolutely shook on the suspension, yes. I mean, the whole thing sort of back and forward, yes.
The M10 wasn't just a weapon, it was home to Ron and his comrades, from the Normandy beaches right up to the fall of Berlin.
It used to be a 5-0 Browning.
It sits at the back in the joint, doesn't it?
Canvas bag for collecting
the spent shells, yeah.
We used to put the army biscuits in that bag and put the bag under the bogey and crush and make porridge with her.
But the memory that's firmest in Ron's mind are the hectic preparations for D-Day itself.
to be able to waterproof every seam and put a canvas screen on the gun screen.
If you look around on the front of the mantlet, just behind on the turret is the mount for it.
Well, isn't there? Yeah.
And when we took the racking off, the canvas is still sandwiched, and on the back of her.
Yeah, well, we had to weld some big chutes up from the back, and also from the engine doors.
In all, about 400 Achilles were involved in the Normandy campaign. Many like Ron's firing up their engines in the first waves of the assault. Now, 60 years later, it's time for me to see what she can do.
Now,
that's the clutch pedal.
Yeah.
You don't have a foot brake. Accelerator pedal's down there, on your right. Gear stick, tell you the gears first. Button in.
Yeah.
Right over to your side.
Yeah.
And forward.
So this is either
pull
track,
left, yeah. Pull left for left and pull right for right, basically. That is it.
This all is we do.
In 1944, this 31-ton beast could clock up an impressive 20 miles an hour across country, drinking an incredible gallon of diesel a mile.
So uncomfortable down here, Steve.
It is. I mean, mostly these tanks were designed by people who didn't actually drive them, which is why, like, the hatches are where they are. If we've got a problem with a tank in real life, you'd never get out through that hatch.
I haven't considered the driver at all, have I?
No, at the end of the day, it was a piece of machinery at war, and all we were there for was just moving. That's all we did.
But in a time of war and stress, you want everything as easy as to operate as possible. And it's not, is it?
No, but on paperwork, somebody somewhere probably thought it was.
After 20 minutes in the driving seat, I promoted myself to commander, so as I could get a better view.
You just can't see where the ground's going.
One piece we've still got to attach to turn our M10 into a true D-Day vet. The massive ducts Ron and his comrades fitted for her 200-meter journey to the beach. And if you'd been a German gunner on the 6th of June 1944, this is what you may have seen coming over the skyline.
Salvage Squad revisits a past project next week, catching up on the progress of a 1952 Blackpool tram. Find out more about the show at channel4.com/science. Next tonight to Scotland for an aquatic adventure to the Iron Age. Time Team Special.